It's a pleasure to have Julie Kooch come and talk to us. Julie's book on growing up on Joseph Creek has been out how many? Four or five?
A little longer than that. It came out in December of 05, so basically in six.
Man, almost 10 years. Time flies when you're having fun. And Julie is a retired school teacher, and she now has another life. Well, she's going to the Panama Canal next month, but she has another life. She's been really involved with a health program in Guatemala, and she just did a really nice program for us at Rotary on that. So if you are interested in Guatemala, she's been down, what, three times? And is going down a fourth, installing water systems and stoves in Guatemala. All of which she learned about, I'm sure, on Joseph Creek. where there was clean water. And,
yeah, we didn't have to worry about.
You didn't have to worry about clean water.
Water purification down there, no.
And probably a lot of different kinds of, and ducket stoves?
No, we just had old wood stoves, but O'Neill are the stoves we use in Guatemala.
Remember the ducket? Anybody know a ducket stove besides? Yeah.
I got one here.
Al Ducket made a stove?
Didn't have one of Al's.
You didn't have one of Al's. Okay. Okay. Well, and Julie has her book here. So after the teaser of her presentation, if anybody wants to read more about it, they can do that. Julie?
How long do I have?
What I would say is you talk 20 minutes, 20, 30 minutes, and then let people answer questions. Or if you want to let them interrupt during the way, you can do it that way.
You need to give me a high side of when to start winding it down.
Okay.
We can be here till 5.
Oh. Okay.
Well, it is a real honor to get to be here because I am passionate about Blau County. I'm passionate about Joseph Creek. In fact, I was on my way home from selling. When I refer to the book, this is what the book is going to be. This one, you know. I was coming home from the state fair where I participate in the Oregon Authors Booth, and I sell my book down there every year. And I had some friends who were going to be coming this way, and I was trying to see how far they should come before they should stop and look back at Mount Hood. And so I stopped at the McDonald's at the Dalles, and I got out, and I was walking up toward the McDonald's and looking back, and there were some people at the table outside there, and he was a guy that never meets a stranger, just like I'm a person who never meets a stranger. He and his wife and I started talking about things, and through the conversation, he says, "Do you work for the Chamber of Commerce?" And then, as I said, "No, I don't," I said, no, I don't, but I should, because I'm so passionate about Blau County. He could read that immediately. Let me just give you a quick run through of, you know, from the very beginning, and most of the things, a lot of the things I tell you will be in the book. Maybe I will add some things that aren't in the book. But my roots go very deep. I have great grandparents who homesteaded here. In fact, the big basin between Willow and Bear Creek is called Wamick Basin. And that was my grandmother on my mom's side was born there. Her dad, John Wamick, homesteaded that. As you come across, you come out of the canyon, you head across the straight across the valley down out of Willow and are heading. You'll see it over in the hills a gulch up there, that's Davis Gulch, named after my dad's side of the family. My great-grandfather homesteaded in there. Out on Mar Flat is a place called Mink Ridge, which is named after my grandfather on my mom's side. And my grandmother on my mom's side, I've devoted all the book is about me except one chapter, and it's about my grandma Bertie, because I am so my grandma Bertie. She was just a pioneer woman. She had pioneer blood in her veins, and she went out there as a single woman and homesteaded and met Grandpa, who was a single man on our flat, and then fell in love and got married. But anyway, so there's places in the county named after my family, and my roots run deep. Mom and Dad, they got married in 42. They actually had to ride horses into their first little house, which was a log cabin down Joseph Canyon. And Dad had coached Mom. She had been raised here in Joseph, and she hadn't ridden horses. And he said, "So if the horse starts to slip, be sure you kick your feet out of the stirrups." And so they're going along, and it was icy, and the horse did slip, and Mom did kick her feet out of the stirrups. In fact, to such an extent, she threw her feet up like this, and she went right over backwards off the horse. So that was her first experience of horseback riding down there, but she was okay. And then the next spring, they bought a little ranch where I was raised up at the head of Joseph Creek. Joseph Creek is unique in that generally, you know how when two rivers come together, they take the name of the larger river and carry that name on? Well, Joseph Creek is formed where Crow Creek and chestnut come together. We locals call it chestnut instead of chestnut nuts. That's just what we do. Anyway, the two of them come together and start Joseph Creek. And Berkmeyer's actually have the ranch right where they come together. And my dad's place started like a quarter of a mile below that. It's the first full ranch on Joseph Creek. So that's where I was raised. And it's not as rough there as it is on down the canyon. But we were very poor. Mom said, you know, we were poor, but we didn't know it. Everybody lived the same. We had some milk cows, slopped some pigs, separated the cream from the milk, sent the cream out twice a week on the stage, and fed some bucket calves, raised a few beef cattle for our cash flow to buy the things that we needed, like salt and sugar and gasoline to run the tractor and that sort of thing. When I was very little, my mom was teaching at the little one-room country school up just in 3 miles, and so Dad basically raised us kids, and we went everywhere with him. At that time, of course, no tractor. We had did everything with horses, and Dad would pitch hay on the wagon and feed the cows, and we were always so inquisitive about everything, and I just would ask my dad, well, you know, these baby cattle start showing up. Where do they come from? Well, they come out of the hay. So, of course, yeah, I'm out there just digging like mad, and they're asking me what I'm doing. I said, well, I'm going to find a calf. That's where they came from. But we have a lot of wonderful memories. A bond developed between my dad and I that I know would not have happened had we not had all those years of just being with Dad. And I can still remember him, you know, loading the stack of hay or the off of the stack of hay, the loose hay, and heading for back up where he's going to feed it, and singing at the top of his lungs, you know, just, I can still hear my dad singing those old songs, you know, Forever and Ever, and some of those good old songs. Went to a one-room country school up Chestnut. Well, the interesting thing was my mom taught until it was my brother and I were old enough to go to school, and then there were a lot of Davises. My uncle, we were at the first place, my grandma was at, Bertie was at the second place, my Uncle Don was at the next place. And then on up Crow Creek, you go up Doe Gulch out on top, and my Uncle Roy was up there. Well, all of these kids, so there were a lot of Davis kids. And there was the Daggett logging camp up Chestnut Ways. And so we got a lot of log camp kids. So we had the most probably 13 kids. But it was all well and good until Ron and I got old enough to go to school. And some of the other Davis parents thought Mom would be partial to Ron and I, and it would not be good to have her teaching, so she did not get to teach. So they brought in a teacher for us in the first grade who was, I look back now and I feel so sorry for her, because she was a city gal and she would have to finish up her work, and in the winter when it gets dark so early, it would be dark, and when she would head home, and she lived with other people, and she lived up a little draw we call Calf Creek with Jerry and Virginia Fine, and she would have to wade across Chestnut River. It froze till there was ice, but not enough you could walk clear across. And then walk up that canyon with all those night. Sounds as if she must have been petrified, the poor woman, but she wasn't really nice. We didn't like her. She would, one time she put me between my brother and my cousin Lyle. We were all in first grade. I was supposed to keep them from playing, you know. And, well, I'd look at the front one and he was, here he has a Kleenex over his face and his eyes, and he's going, bleh, bleh, bleh. I look back this way, they're back like this, so we all got a giggle. Well, she stood up in front of them, and she had this, not just a little thin yard, she was about that big, and she hit us, and she'd say, laugh, if you want to laugh, laugh. I said, laugh. Of course, I was bawling my teeth in. And then my brother was left-handed. She decided, no, could not do that, could not have a left-handed child, so she tied his hand behind his back. And the folks said, if you get in trouble at school, you are in a lot more trouble at home. And so we agreed amongst us all the cousins that we would not tell on Ronnie. And one day it slipped out, and the folks said, what? And so then she was gone after that year. And then Mrs. Gladys Quinn came and taught us her second, third grades. And then by then, the other day's kids were gone, and Mom was allowed to come back and teach, and she taught me the rest of my years there. When I was little, my dad was the first manager on the B&H ranch up the Chestnut, and so had some wonderful experiences up there. But then we went back to, and while we were there, my grandma Katie, dad's mom, came down and lived in our little house and built too big a fire and burned the house down. And so when we left B&H, we didn't have any place to go, so we went and moved in with my grandma in her log house. So we lived with grandma in the log house for a while. Some of the things that we encountered were, that made it a hardship was, we didn't even have a barn. There was a line of stanchions out next to the trail. And Bud Berkmeyer still just shakes his head and says, I can still just see my mom's name was Maxine, but you date yourself by if you call my mom Maxine or Mickey. When we moved to the Valley for us kids to go to high school, mom started going by Maxine. But before that, she was always Mickey to everybody. So, but so you can see Melvin and Mickey down there, rain, shine, snow, or whatever, milking the cows. And I can remember them, I fixed some kind of a little tent thing when we were little toddlers, they couldn't leave us in the house. And with a kind of a roof over us and so forth to protect us a little bit while they milked the cows. And then they let us kids start learning how to milk cows on the cows they wanted to dry up, because if you don't milk a cow completely dry, she starts producing less and less. But you just want to milk enough to take the pressure off of her udder and make her comfortable. And so they would do that while they put us, one of us on each side of this cow, and I was on the wrong side of the cow from what you generally milk, but she was fine with it. But the next cow to us, I guess I must have touched her or something, and the next thing I knew, a hoof caught me in the head and rolled me clear across over against the pole fence behind. I can remember you said coming out like that, and mom running to the house and getting a towel and putting on and so forth. It must have been, as a parent, I look at it a lot differently, you know, and as an adult, and think the worry that they must have had of raising children down there, being so isolated. At one time, we were snowed in for 6 weeks, and my Uncle Don, clear at the end of the line, would drive the mail. So he'd gather the mail and bring it out and then bring it back. Well, but he didn't show up for a while. We're like, okay, something's wrong. And so they sent a plane in. Our place was the last place where the canyon was straight enough and wide enough to land a plane. So they landed a plane in there. And my Uncle Don, then, who was a big man, was to take the mail out and get a few supplies for everybody. And as he started to get into the plane, he started to kick the snow off of his feet and kick the hole in the plane. Later he said, can you even imagine how I felt crawling into that flimsy little contraption? But they made it fine. But one of the things mom ordered was a side of bacon, because she thought, well, she could bake, put bacon with beans, she could have some breakfast meat and so forth. And so that was one of the things she ordered. And so at that time, you'd buy a whole slab of bacon on the Rhine. And so everybody was just jubilant and in a party mood. And so we said, oh, let's go on down to Uncle Don and Aunt Mary's and play cards. It was very customary, Mary, to play cards all night and then have breakfast together and then go home. And so Dad goes out and loads some hay, pitches loose hay on the wagon and hooks the horses up. And us kids nestle down in it, and down the canyon we go. Well, as the night went on, it's really crooked down where Uncle Don is, so the wind wasn't blowing real hard, but you could tell, you know, there's a wind going on somewhere. And so then we left and came home. We didn't stay clear till morning. It was in the middle of the night, and as we came up the canyon, the wind just got stronger and stronger and stronger. And we got up to our place, their yard gates were flopping, and the back screen door was just flopping. We had an ice box, but we didn't, of course, have a refrigerator. Well, at that time of year, it was cold enough that Mom just put bacon out on the back porch. Well, the old sow pig had gotten got clear into the back porch, and she just slicked that bacon. They're just laying the rind. Absolutely, she slicked that bacon to the cleaner you could ever cut it with a knife. And her mom just started crying. Just, you know, there was our meat. But growing up down there was just one incident like that after another. But like I said, you know, we were poor, but we didn't know it. I never went to bed hungry. I always had a roof over my head. We all slept, Mom, Dad, my brother and I, in one little room. It was so cold in the winter. It was old Warden Batten house, never had seen any paint. So beautiful barn boards, what you know we seek for now. That's what it's just one story, little shacky house. Mom and Dad would build a fire, and of course have a good fire going in the wood stove. They'd hold blankets up and have us kids stand there and get warm and get the blankets warm. And then they'd have us spin like a cocoon and wrap up in the blankets, and they'd pick us up and carry us into bed and then put more blankets over us. And our blankets honestly froze to the walls. That side of the bed. We were warm, but our blankets froze to the walls. But we were warm, you know, and I consider myself very fortunate in the lifestyle of I'm glad I was poor. I'm glad I know what poor is. I have more of an empathy for people who are poor and an understanding and good work ethic, you know, on a farm like that. Everybody has a job and everybody has to work. And us kids used to have to get up and milk cows and so forth with Mom and Dad, you know, before we go to school and do it when we got home and do all kinds of chores. Later then, my life slipped by. We moved to the valley for us kids to go to high school because my dad said, we're not farming the kids out. We're going to take them out. We're going to raise them. So he rented a ranch out here in the valley, and so we farmed it in conjunction with Joseph Creek while we were in there. And then I went to college. So many young people can't get out of Lowell County fast enough, but I never had that desire to get out of Lowell County. Other than I knew I had to. My mom preached education to us kids because my dad was from a big family, and all of my cousins, there's one became a lawyer, and then my brother and I got education, and that's all out of like 20, 30, somewhere between 20 and 30 cousins. But mom just preached and preached, you know. And dad would have liked to have a big family, and mom was smart enough to know we cannot afford it, so we had only the two kids. So since this is an adult class, I'll tell you a funny one on my mom. She, in the chieftain then, they would always put out at the end of the year all of the deaths, the births, the weddings, the divorces, all this. And so here comes the births, and on January the 31st, Melvin Maxine Davis are the proud parents of the boy, blah, 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 blah. December 18th, same calendar year. December 18th, Melvin Maxine Davis are the proud parents of the blah, blah, blah. And mom was just embarrassed. She said, Melvin, I think we're just like a couple of rabbits. It was nice because we were close in age, and you know, little girls grow faster than little boys do, and I got pictures where I was this much taller than him, and I get just whip the daylights out of him. Later, I wished I'd been better to him, but for a while I could whip him. But anyway, those are some of the hardships, and yet the community center was around the school, and we'd have pie socials, we'd have basket socials, you know, we'd put the whole dinner together and sell them off, and we always put on plays, you know, at Christmas and everything. But then later, like I said, we came out to high school. I went away to college, and when I went away to college, I had it well thought out. All along, I thought, I got to do something that I can go back to Lowell County. Well, there are elementary children everywhere who need taught. So I thought, if I get an education in elementary education, so I can be an elementary teacher, I will be guaranteed I will be able to go back to Lowell County, and that's exactly what I did. I did teach 1 year in Vail while my husband got, and he was down there too working, and then he got a job here, and so we got to go back to Lowell County. And I've been here ever since. So the only time I've been gone is to go to college, and that 1 year of teaching. And I have a passion for Lowell County, and I could talk about Lowell County. And when I do see people, I start telling about Lowell County. Well, down at the book fair, you know, the Lowell County Chamber has put a booth down there for several years, but I'm a one man booth. But everybody goes, you got to come see Lowell County and so forth. But as an adult, then my husband and I bought my dad and grandma's place. Long story short, bad divorce. He got the place, and you know, I could have let it destroy me, but it's just a thing. I was not going to do that. And the canyons somehow just keep calling me back and calling me back. And then I became very good friends of a guy who was a cow boss on the Monument Ranch, and which is clear down the canyon. And in fact, that is Bud Burkmeyer used to own that. His granddad, Alvin McFetridge, put 6 homesteads together. And the last half of the book is a lot about the Monument Ranch, the development of it, and the things we did there. Those homesteads down in the canyon are not 160 squares. Some of them are 139.8, 142.7, but they would homestead wherever they could find a flat place big enough to raise enough hay for a milk cow and build a little cabin. And then you might go on down the canyon 3-5 miles before you do another one. But anyway, he put together 6 of these. And then the people that homesteaded had the grazing rights on the government land around those. And so he put together, Alvin McFetridge put together those. And there's a lot of interesting information of what it took him to do that. And then the ranch sold, changed hands. Bud Burkmeyer had it for years when I was a little girl. In fact, Ron and I, when we were in grade school, bought 2 horses from Bud. And I had a little 2-year-old filly, and Ron got a little 3-year-old gelding, and we first horses we broke. I think I was in the 6th grade or something like that. And so my connection with the Monument Ranch goes back to clear when I was a child, and we'd go down there and visit sometimes and so forth. And then as an adult, like I said, after Roger and my divorce and so forth, I became friends with this guy who was a cow boss down there, so then I spent 8 years, wonderful years down here, and thrills and chills and spills and horse wrecks and things that you couldn't believe. So the second half of the book is on that. And then Lee got hurt really bad, and then he eventually passed away. And so once again, it's like my canyon is gone, but Tom Burkmeyer Mac's youngest boy's running a ranch there, and he knew that it was so important to me. And a lot of ranchers, cattle ranchers in Lyle County, the big ranchers, don't want a woman on the place. They don't want to put up with a woman. And they think somebody they're going to have to babysit or something. Well, Tom was so good that he knew how important it was to me, so he let me just come along and ride along. And after 1 year, he says, "Julie, you know, you're good help. You're worth wages, not just free grass." And so I started working for Tom for wages, and then now I'm also riding on the 3V Ranch, which is Dwayne Voss down on Horse Creek in Naha. And absolutely love it. People think I'm crazy, but I absolutely love that steep country. I absolutely love it. I go down there, and pictures I get, there's just like calendar. I go around and draw, and there's another picture perfect, you know, calendar picture and so forth. And so my life goes on, and still, I'm still doing the same lifestyle, the canyon cowboying, which is actually it's an art that is vanishing. And it is an art. It is a developed skill. It is so different than just driving cattle out on the flat land. And there are fewer and fewer people who know how to do it. There are fewer and fewer people who even want to do it. In fact, with Dwayne this last spring was riding, and Dwayne and I go into the steep stuff and get the stuff out, and he even has guys that won't go into the steep. In fact, one gal told me later, she said, yeah, her husband is also a Dwayne. She said, yeah, Dwayne came home last night saying, I would have gone where Julie went yesterday, but I have a wonderful horse and I love it. And I think that love of it and that desire is what makes it go. That's just a quick overrun of my life. If you have any questions, the book, let me tell you just a tiny bit about it. Every picture that I have, except I think for one picture, if I'm not in it, I'm the one behind the camera taking it. There's 462 pictures, 160 of them are colored. The colored ones are basically of when we were on the Monument Ranch, because when I was a little kid, we didn't have colored photography. But there's pictures in here of the log house. There's the picture my grandma homestead now on Mar Flat and so forth. And then the colored pictures are here in the back, cow camps, riding different places, and so forth. I could tell you a lot of interesting thrills and chills and spills that we had on the Monument, but it's just, you know, if you want to hear about them.
Tell about the rattlesnakes.
Oh, the rattlesnakes. You know, I have friends who won't go down there and ride with me because they don't want the rattlesnakes. But I'm just stubborn and independent enough that I'd be blessed if the rattlesnake's going to detect, tell me where I am going to go or not. And you learn to be very careful. In fact, when you pick up a bale of hay, you roll it towards you. You know, so the rattlesnake can go out that side. And I laugh at myself because when I was on the Monument Ranch and I still had my place out here, I would find myself out here in the valley doing it the rattlesnake style, you know. But one time we killed a rattlesnake, we just absolutely pulverized his head, put him in a coffee can, and we were going to go to town, so we stopped somewhere for some reason, at Burkmeyer's, and just Mac and Marion and Tommy and Merle out there, and just for fun, Lee said, "Oh, look at the snake we killed." And I couldn't believe it. That thing had been like 2 or 3 hours, and it had no head left. I swear, it had no head left. But it blew stuff out of that. Mac and Mary just put the leg back on that thing. Yeah, we were always killing rattlesnakes. And really, you know, lots of times you just let them go if they're not bothering you. But when we would move to the top with the cattle in the summer and not be around the place down there, invariably the snakes would move in because there wasn't activity. And so the first time we would go back, go into the barn, and all that, we have to be very careful because there generally always were rattlesnakes in there.
Didn't you tell a story about someone pulling the snakes out of the pit and you kids killing them or something?
Wasn't me. That was Bud Burkmeyer and his grandma, Gertie McFetry, the people who put that together. There is a snake pit by trail 2 miles from the ranch house at the bottom, and she took Bud and Mac, little grandkids, up there, and she had a hoe handle with a nail they'd driven in the end and made a hook. And in the spring and fall, the snakes will stay around the mouth of the pit. In the spring, they come out and get warm and go back in, but they're stay around pretty close. Well, she took those two little boys up there, and it's steep. And she was raking back in here and raking these snakes out and flipping them over her shoulder down the hill. And the little boys were supposed to beat them to death before they got back to her. Snakes, old snakes, stuff up there. Yeah, those boys. And Bud is so, he talks slow. And And I said, "So, Bud, why did your grandma do that?" And he said, "Well, I guess just to scare the hell out of us." "Well, did it work?" He said, "Yep."
Is that the family that had the cave and she raised 12 kids in the cave during the winter or something like that?
There is a cage on down Joseph Creek that, hi Judy, I didn't see you speak in, that young Chief Joseph was born in. And I've got pictures of it in there now. It is so overgrown with blackberry bushes and stuff, you can't hardly see it was there. And the people who own the property won't let you there. When we used to go down there all the time, Tibbetts. It's too bad it wasn't set aside as, you know, the tribe didn't set it aside before. The people who got it now, I don't know what it would take to get it done, but it would have been nice to have it as a kind of a monument thing. Rich?
Julian, there's a Bly Edgman Ranch, and one of the Blys wrote a book.
I have it.
Okay. And there are pictures of Indians in braids and with teepees in the 20s on Joseph Creek.
Now that,
Did they keep coming back to work on the ranches then some in your time, or was that pretty much over?
You know, they came to lower Joseph Creek that you get into from Asopi. And
okay.
They didn't come clear up to us, so we did not experience them.
Okay.
But I know, I saw those pictures too. Yeah, Blind Indians. And the Indians, you know, I don't know. Did you read? Did you have a book? I read it a long time ago, but I don't remember what he said about that. If they were coming to work, or if they were just allowed to come back and fish, I don't know.
Well, no, they worked there, and there were pictures of their braids. They've got chaps on.
Oh, yeah.
They're dressed, you know.
Yeah.
And then I guess one of the, I can't remember whether Edgman or Bly, one of them actually learned.
Yes.
They said learned some of the Nez Perce songs and some of the language. But they had their teepees down there.
They're also from, you go out to the, on the North Highway to the Joseph Canyon overlook,
right.
Which is, when they redid it, they did a beautiful job. And there's a lot of information there about the Native Americans. So they did a beautiful job of doing that. And they tell about, there's a cave. When you look down in there, you're looking on what we call the Wilder Place, one of those homesteads. In fact, I have a picture of the book from right there at the viewpoint, looking down at the Wilder Place. But as you look down on that viewpoint, off to your left around is a big cave, that the Indians stashed some dry blankets, dried food, and so forth. And in 1877, when they collected them up and ran them out of here, they knew they wouldn't get all the young bucks that some of them would seek off. And so to make it difficult for those young bucks to stay here, I don't know how they got wind of it, but the military got wind of that, and so they went into that cave and destroyed all of their bedding and all their foods and their provisions, just to make it hard on them. So then there's also a big petrified rock up out on what we call Table Mountain. It's down over, out on a point. It's not clear on the top. If you know where to look for it, you can see it from the viewpoint, but it's pretty hard to see if you don't know what you're looking for. But it is probably as high as almost as high as these highest timbers up here, and there's a kind of a crevice up it, and there used to be an old pole ladder. Bud Berkmeyer and the guys would go up it, and then there's a can on the top with names of people that have climbed to the top. Well, I was hunting one year with this cow boss, and I said, I had a big old hunting boots. I wasn't prepared for climbing, but I said, I remember me being younger than I am today. I want to climb that rock today. Well, the ladder's completely shot, so I just went up the crevice, which put my back against me, forgetting it's a lot easier to go up than it is to come down. You get to the top, and you have to go around a little ledge, and on. So I get up there, and I left the camera with Lee so he could take pictures of me up there and all this stuff. And I was up there for a while, and he hollers up and says, "I did find a can." I said, "Oh, yeah, here is the can with names in it." So he hollers and says, "Did you put my name in it?" He's a big smart mouth I am. I said, "Are you up here?" So I'm just having a good time. Pretty quick, I start to get down, and I cannot back around that ledge and get down. And I tried and I tried, and finally I said, "Lee, I can't get down. But there is a rock up here. If you throw me up your lariat, I'll put a loop around that, and then I can let myself down." It was quiet for a little while, and he says, And then how are you going to get my rope down? I said, I don't know. And he said, well, I'm not leaving my rope here. At that time, we looked down, and here came some hunters that he had met in a hunting camp a few days before. And one of those guys luckily had a rope, so we tied the two together and made a loop around there. I'd still be up there. Cowboys love their hats and their ropes. That's the two most important things to their hats and their ropes. So anyway, I got off of the rock. Anybody have any other questions?
Well, yeah. Can you talk about some of the original homesteaders? I've hiked down to the Wilder place and also the Botter place off the highway. And,
okay.
And were they, when did they stop being down there? Were they there when you were there?
There are some interesting stories about them. Old Mr. Wilder was a professor from clear back east. And nobody knows exactly why he came out here, but he came out and he went down and he homesteaded down there. And he planned to live there till he died. And so he started building this big pier of all of this burnable stuff. And Wendy Burley lived the next place down, and he said, when I die, I want you to throw me on there and burn me up. And everybody else went, oh. Well, Wendy Burley said, my God, if he wants to burn, I'll burn him. and then old man Wilder would, Bud Berkmeyer witnessed this. He would sit there, he'd make biscuits, and he didn't trim his fingernails. He'd make biscuits, and he'd get dough on his fingernails. But then he'd set the table, and he'd be real still, and doggone mice would crawl up the table leg, crawl on the table, and eat the dough out from under his feet.
Oh, my God.
So then, out of the was able to buy, up on top of Cougar Creek is the Larson place, old Swede Larson. He worked for my dad, who's an old man. When we were at B&H, your dad hired him on as just kind of a chore boy. They say, you know, the best judgment of character are dogs and children. And I tell you, I love that old man. He was so, but he's the old man who had homesteaded up on that Cougar bench. And the only way you could get in there, you couldn't get in with a wagon. Everything had to be packed in on pack animals. That's one of the homesteads. And then there's the cousin's homestead down on the bottom and on down. Tibbetts homesteaded some. The Tibbetts place, which later became the Bunny House. A lady was able to buy that for taxes. And there's a lot of interesting history. And I went to the courthouse and I researched every one of those from the time they were homesteaded to Dubon, and there's a lot of interesting stuff going on. But anyway, Mr. McFedridge put all of that together. And he got all of it except the Wilder, or the Botter place, and it's right at the mouth of Swamp Creek. But he had the Wilder place on down, and he ran all sheep down there then. And I have to laugh, everywhere in this deep country, you know how the sheepmen and the cattlemen, there were all those wars. Little did the sheep man know that he was opening up this country for cattle. Because if the sheep hadn't gone on that steep country, you look at those hills and they just look honeycombed, the sheep made those trails, and then the cattle went on. If they had not been sheep, their cattle would have never started grazing those hills. But now the cattle grazing make the trails even bigger and nicer. But the sheep man opened it up for the cattlemen and, well, you know, Jidge Tip and all that. They were sheepmen to begin with. But anyway, so Alvin would go clear to the Wilder place and run his sheep and so forth. And he wanted that Wilder place so bad. Well, one day, Alvin is working there at the home place, the town place, and Mr. Wilder, Clayton Wilder, come riding up the trail, and apparently he didn't see what happened. His dog ran ahead, and he ran right up to Alvin McFedridge, hiked his leg, peed on it. It made Alvin so mad, he grabbed up a rock and he ran that dog. Well, that's all that old Wilder saw was him, and it made him so mad he came charging up there his horse, and just the brisk of his horse, he just whammed into Alvin and just knocked him flat. And so Alvin, you son of a gun, and grabbed up a rock and threw it at him, and then he's cussing, I'm sure, and Wilder started away from him, and Alvin picked up a rock and I made him right between the shoulder blades, and he said, oh, he carried on like he was just dead. Got killed him. And so then Alvin McFedridge said that Clayton Wilder would have sold to the devil himself for it, sold to him. And so for years he couldn't get his hands on, but then he finally did get that place. And I can remember, and I cannot remember if it's the old, I can't remember if it was Clayton Wilder or if it was the old cousins. What was the cousin? Right now I can't think of the cousin's first name. But one of those guys would come up the canyon and stop at our place in our little old shack, and Mom and Dad had gotten Ron and I some roller skates, the kind of with the key, and you put them on your shoes. And our old house was just like, you know, these old floors were just swooping off everywhere. And I can remember this guy, he'd get us kids up, and rooms were tiny, but seemed pretty big to us kids. And he put those skates on us, and he'd let us go. And we'd go, I mean, we're little tykes, and we go smack into that wall, and he just laughed and laughed and dragged and let us go back into that wall. But so they were fun. They were, you know, single guys, never been married, but they were fun guys.
So it was your grandmother that was that single homesteaded, or your great grandmother?
My grandmother. Grandma.
So what? Tell us about what caused her to do that.
I'll tell you. She never openly complained much, but the feel I got of it was she didn't get a real square deal at home. And she had some real pretty little dainty sisters who they kind of made over, and they just made Grandma a workman.
Oh.
And she, then her mom died. And so, and the sisters are going off getting married, and so Grandma just have to do more and more work. That's when she decided she would go, and back then all you had to do was take a test to be a teacher. And Grandma took a test to be a teacher, so she taught out of promise. And she stayed with the Gorbits and the Hendersons. Said they were wonderful people. Couldn't say enough good about those people. And then she'd ride back and help Grandpa. And then she finally, you know, decided, if I'm going to do all this work, I'm going to do it for myself. So then she went out to Mar Flat. And while she was there, and I have her little ledger, while she was out there, not only did she homestead, she ran the mail route.
Huh.
Horseback with a pack horse. And she'd buy supplies for the people. And I have a little ledger. She bought, you know, 5 pounds of coffee for somebody and 10 pounds of sugar and so forth from Mar Flat back to here. And then she'd stay overnight. And then she'd go back the next day. But she then once rode from Malawa before she left and started doing this. She rode from Lawa to Copen one day. I mean, you have some really fast walking horses. You can go 50, 60 miles a day. A long day, but you can do it. And you run some, you walk some, you trot some. Yeah, so she carried the mail route from out there, too. But she's the grandma that, it's funny how traits seem to jump generations sometimes, because she and Grandpa got married, and then out there, you know, the homesteading thing was such a farce, because they should have had at least 10 different types of ground. You could have 160 acres out in that dry, rocky hills, or you could have 160 acres in the lush valley. There's no way you can make a living. 160 acres out there. And so they just went broke. Well, Grandma and Grandpa sold off to some other people, and they moved back to town, and Grandpa started working for the railroad. So Mom was raised here in Joseph. They lived out there until Mom was born, but then they moved into Joseph. But anyway, then my mom had absolutely no pioneer blood in her veins. No adventuresomeness, nothing. But then I am just so my grandma. She loved horses, and she loved her flowers, and she loved ranch work. You know, and that's when I was a little kid. My mom, I'm thankful she did. She made me learn how to, you know, bake bread and all these things. But I would get in and do all these domestic duties just so I could get outside and be my daddy's shadow. I just followed him everywhere. And even today, sometimes I'll do something and I'll think, how did I know how to do that? And I know it's just way back in my mind of something I watched my dad do when I was a little girl. And it's just stuck there, and it didn't surface when I needed it. But we had to create our own fun. You know, of course, no TV. We read lots of books, and Mom and Dad, we played games, card games. We kids learned how to play canasta and clean up everything. We were just, you know, first, second grade. And then in the summer, I remember one summer we decided we were going to make a raft. And so we went and cut all of these logs and put them together as a raft. Well, we weren't smart enough to realize that they weren't really dry. They were pretty wet and heavy. But Dad was good, and he said he'd pull it up to under that big chestnut bridge. There was a hole under there, and help us dump it in the river. Well, actually, our air turned out to be really fun, because this old raft was probably 8 feet by 8 feet, and it would just barely float. But if we get on one side of it, it'd stand almost on end, and we scramble up it, and then he'd go, whoop! and then we do that hour after hour. Kids learn how to create your own fun. You know, we didn't have anybody to entertain us, but we had a lot of fun doing that. I remember once coming home from school, and Mom, we took our swimsuits to school with us, and it was late in the fall, but it was really warm, and we went swimming and after school, and finally after dark, I can hear the big moon coming up, everything. Dad finally drives up there to see what we're doing, and we're having so much fun just playing and swimming that we didn't come home for supper. There's lots of interesting things to do out there.
As a kid and playing in all that area, do you find any artifacts?
Do you know what? I am blind to artifacts. I've never found an arrowhead in my life. I could be right there in the mouth of Sumac. There was a big Indian camp encampment there, and Uncle Don would work that field over. And I'd be walking out through there with my cousins, and oh, they found arrowheads and stuff all the time. She'd be walking, she'd, oh! And I cannot find them. I've never found one in my life. But they are, yeah, other it's people did, lots of them, lots of them.
Have you found a cougar yet, Julie?
Cougar?
Yeah, like you say that it lives along the county. Always expect a ridge that you might find one.
Yeah. You know, yeah, when we're out there riding, especially on the Monument Ranch, there's just so many places where there'd be a big old pine tree. You have sometimes pine trees have a big old limb that breaks off and goes down to the ground. And when you're driving a bunch of cattle, you aren't going to see wildlife because there's too much noise. But when you're just riding from point A to B, quietly riding along, I kept thinking, you know, I ought to see a cougar, and never once did I see a cougar. I've run up onto bear, but I've never seen a cougar except driving a rig on the road, like coming out late at night or something, and a cougar running across the road or something. Nope, still have never seen a cougar. I did ride for Dwayne Voss on Brushy, saw a wolf last year.
Wow. What about fish? I think I remember story of someone pitchforking the salmon out or seal. Is that your
my grandma Berthy?
Yeah, right.
We'd have to cross Sumac, and right where the water comes out, right at the mouth of Sumac, it just pans out to the water's really shallow, and we'd have to cross that and then go over on the hill to bring in the milk cows, and sometimes we'd start across there, and here would be a salmon. Plug yours, Jim. There'd be a salmon going through, and you know, half out of the water, just going like that, and grandma would say, run to the barn, kids, get the pitchfork, get the pitchfork. We'd run to the barn and get the pitchfork, we'd pitch out. Fish, we said, what fish do you get? Yeah. Yeah. We did. Yeah. We, and you know, I was raised on wild meat. And I can't say I'm proud of it, but I can't say I'm ashamed of it either. We were very poor. We never wasted a thing. Dad killed for us to have some meat. I remember one winter we had run out of meat to the point we hadn't had enough protein. We were not feeling well, and Mom said, no, you've got to get us some meat. And so Dad would kill a deer, you know. And so, yeah, I was raised on illegal meat, fish, deer. In fact, there's a story in the book of they had not had any doe hunts because they were trying to build up the herds of deer out in the hills. And my brother-in-law was the one to always say the wrong thing. And my mom's uncle had come from Portland, and Dad took him hunting, and there's a picture in there of this buck that looks like a small elk, huge, bigger body than anything you see now, but ran out, and they hung him in the willow tree right in front of the house, and Ron went out and saw it, came running back in and just screamed at me, oh, sissy, come quick, come quick. Daddy finally got one with horns. You know, it's a hard life, the ranching and so forth, but I tell you, it's a good life. It's a lifestyle that it's hard to explain if you've never actually been a part of it. The conclusion of my book kind of sums up my love for the country and for all of that. And I'm so thankful that I'm still involved in, you know, still riding for Dwayne and Tom. Let me read this to you, the conclusion. In looking back over the years, I have many memories. There were those times riding down a windswept ridge in a snowstorm when it seemed we would be blown off of our horses, when we were almost too cold to care. There were those days when we would once again say, this has to be the most beautiful day I've ever seen. There were the struggles of assisting in the birth of or bringing in a chilled down calf, of trying to push cattle when they refused to move, the lazy lunches by a cool stream as the horses grazed in grass up to their knees, the ecstasy of glassing the brakes and spotting that herd of elk bedded down on a south bench, or an eagle lazily soaring in the updraft silhouetted against the royal blue sky. Having spent those years on the Monument Ranch, I again developed a real attachment to the ranch and the canyon. Through riding for cattle, I came to know every canyon, ridge, and draw as well as I knew the back of my hand. Did the good balance the bad? No. It far outweighed it. We were rich beyond anything that money could buy. No wonder we frequently found ourselves saying, I wonder what the poor folks are doing. You see, working the Monument Ranch was not a job, it was a way of life. The Monument Ranch was what Wallowa County used to be. And it was because we still did things, you know, the old style way. We fed all the cattle with teams and so forth. And so I got to keep that style of life, you know, till not so very long ago. There are still some remote places. Down on Joseph Creek is probably the most remote place in Wallowa County. You think, oh, well, the Snake River. But, you know, if you're on the Snake River, there's that boat traffic. And there's always, you know, you could hail somebody down. But when you're down there, if something goes wrong, you are on your own, you know. Now Lathrop's have the ranch up the canyon from the Monument Ranch. But it's a long ways, you know, a long ways up there.
How many people were in your school?
Well, I think the most there ever were when I was there in first grade, maybe we had 13 or so, something like that. And then we lost the Daggett logging camp, and it really dwindled. And so the last couple of years, there were three of us, my brother and I and one other little girl. Her dad was on the lookout up at Red Hill, and then they would come down to lived in the Hinton house there at where the old Daggett logging camp used to be.
Is it hard finding horses that can safely negotiate the steeps, or is that a rare horse, or is it just a matter of time working with?
It's extremely hard. Right now, my horse he's incredible. He is so good, but he's getting old, and I'm looking for a new one. And Dwayne knows if I'm going to keep riding that steep country, he's got to keep me safe. Mm-hmm. And so he is good enough. He is selling me. I'm taking possession of the horse next summer. A colt that was, the mother raised the colt down there. It was turned out as a yearling on the steep hills there in Sheep Creek. And that's what Dwayne does with all of his colts. He turns them out to winter on the steep hillsides. And you got to make it, or if you're going to slide, do it while you're young, because I don't want you sliding when I'm on you. And then he sends them up the river to Grouse Creek to Luke Morgan. And Luke Morgan breaks them. And Dwayne said, okay, when I get them back, I want to be able to pack them, ride them, open gates on them, cross rivers, drag a calf to the, and it gives us, and they can do it. Wow. And so I am getting to buy. In fact, Dwayne was giving me a bad time. I went to down Horse Creek with him Sunday, and he said, boy, I had to really fight to keep this other guy, rancher, out here in Upper Prairie Creek from, he saw the horse I want, and this guy saw him, and all of a sudden just kept, dang it, Dwayne, decided that horse, he said, you're going to have to fight Julie Kooch over that horse. And I said, yeah, you're right. You go into that country on what we call a flatland horse, and you'll get killed. Uh-huh. They'll kill you.
Now how old will that horse be when you start working it?
Oh, he's really going to be a little bit older than what I want. He'll be 8 next summer. Uh-huh. I'd like, it'd been fine for me if he'd have been 5 or 6.
Yeah.
The horse I have now is 5 or 6, but that's okay. You know, I think, well, 8, and if I ride him 8 more years, you know, yeah. That puts me up there a few more years, but I still probably will get me one more horse, I'm hoping. But it is, it's hard to find. I mean, you talk about a good ranch gilding, you know, get in line. There are people wanting them everywhere. In fact, I went to the High Lakes with some friends just before I went to the state fair, and the guy that was behind me after a while said, Julie, I was just watching that horse of yours and how carefully he puts his feet. And he gets in a tight spot, and he doesn't scrap. Now, some horses, they get scared, and they just want to get through it fast and scramble, and that's dangerous. And he just watches where he puts every foot. He's excellent. He's got some other really bad habits. We say, of course, there's something wrong with him, a bad habit or something. We say they have a hole in them. And so when I go to somebody and say, what's a hole in this horse? And they say, he ain't got one. I say, you're lying to me, because every horse has a hole. There's something, you know. My horse pulls back. He'll just... he'll be fine, and then you tie him to something, you might go 6 months, and then all of a sudden, you know, there's just, he, and he's not a good walker, he's long-legged, but he doesn't walk fast enough, and, you know, every horse has something. Yeah. So if they tell you that, not that you better watch out. Well, thank you guys for the opportunity to get to share this, and my books are for sale, if anybody wants one, they're $20, and the reason they're that expensive is because of all of the colored pictures, the color printing was, so I'd be glad to autograph if anybody wants one.